Peace is in the sky. Peace is in space, on the earth, and in the waters. The herbs and trees are full of peace. The gods are peaceful. Brahman is peace. All is peace, peace, peace alone. May that peace enter me. Om peace, peace, peace. The subject this morning is ideal society and the future of Vedanta. I went to a wonderful synagogue the other day. It's my shul now. It's called Ikar, Lady Rabbi Evangelical. A lot of singing, wonderful. Saturday. And they started off with this prayer. Adonai, God, whose spirit is in all creatures, we pray that your spirit be awakened within all the inhabitants of our land. Uproot from our hearts hatred and malice, jealousy and strife. Plant love and companionship, peace and friendship among the many peoples and faiths who dwell in our nation. Grant us the knowledge to judge justly, the wisdom to act with compassion, the understanding and courage to root out poverty from our land. May it be your will that our land be a blessing to all who dwell on earth, and may you cause all people to dwell in friendship and freedom. Speedily fulfill the words of your prophets. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And for all of them, to the greatest, shall know me. And let us say, they said, Amen. Now, you know, we have an interesting exemplar. And it's taken me a while to reach this plane of the first day of the new year, where I feel very optimistic about us, about our challenge and our opportunity as this new year dawns. Jesus said, better to be doers than hearers only of the word. So I say that, is it not true that in that sense, it's good to say, but it's better to do. And better than that is to be. And what doth the Lord require of us? Says Micah. But to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. It's very interesting, you know, that Lincoln said mercy bears richer fruits than seeking strict justice. And one day he came up with this whangdanger. He said, we have been, this was 1863, and it actually was a Thanksgiving Day proclamation. He said, we've been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We've been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We've grown in numbers, wealth, and power, as no other nation has ever grown. But we've forgotten God. We've forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us, and as have vainly imagined we have in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all those blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own, intoxicated with unbroken success. We become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God that made us. It has seemed to me fit and proper that God should be solemnly, reverently, and gratefully acknowledged, as with one heart and one voice, by the whole American people. I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of the United States, and he said United States, I know for a fact I was there, and also those who are at sea, and those who are sojourning in foreign lands, to set apart and observe the last Thursday of November, updated by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, as a day of thanksgiving and prayer and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. So I thought today it might be worth our time and trouble to examine a little bit, each one in her in his own fashion, the idea of the ideal society that I presume lives within everyone's heart. And then to go on from that and consider the future of the Vedanta Society. Because it occurred to me, friends, on a given night in November, before dawn, that this is God's country. I don't mean like, you know, they say God's going to Massachusetts or something. I mean that the country that we are living in is the country of the Spirit. That's my modern translation of the kingdom of God, which Jesus says is within. It's God's country. It's the country of God. And from this plane, don't you see, we can look down. It's a dimension. And we see these little jigsaw pieces down there interlocking and partly finished and, you know, how it is. Space over there, some sky, some trees, a little lake. And these jigsaw pieces down there, my friends, are the countries of the world. And yes, the parties. And it seems to me that as a remnant, a saving remnant, a few shepherds and shepherdesses here sheltered under the eaves from the storm. Nice rain we had the last few days. That we are now called upon to see the opportunity in living above that in God's country. So we heard what Micah said. Let's hear what Jesus has to say about it. This country of God, this kingdom of God. He was up there one day and he was saying something like this. He said, speaking of God as a king, he said, the king will say to you, come, you who are blessed by my Father. It's Jesus. Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. So for I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill. And you cared for me in prison. And you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? Or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you? Or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill? Or in prison and visit you? And the king will say to them in reply, Amen. I say to you, whatever you did to one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on his left, you didn't do it, did you? We'll talk about that another time. Got more to say with you. Alrighty, I think we can have a little fun today, because you know, if it's not irreligious, at least it's irregular when you and I get together. And that for those that need to know, there's still time. You can still catch at least half of the service. This place is conveniently located to schools, churches, and fire departments, you know. There's lots of churches around here that will be wonderful places to go. But this, my friends, should have been notified ahead of time as the meeting of the evangelical wing of the Vedanta Society. Our brother Atmarupananda, boy, when he gets going, he's something else. And that's a whole other story about him and me. I'm his puppy dog, because I thought he was born in South Carolina, actually born in Georgia. Home to me is Southern Illinois. You should probably know that sometime. And I'm his puppy dog because a long time ago he sent me 2 postcards from Lincoln Land. He did. From, New Salem, where he practiced law. He came from Indiana as a grown man. And then from his home. And he didn't need to do that. It's noted that he gave a talk about Robert E. Lee once at the Vedanta Society. He didn't need to do that, but he did. So unfortunately, right now, anything he asked me to do, I'm going to try to get around to seeing how it can be done. He's got an interesting little point here in Vedanta for the West. He said, he's in India now, so it's safe. He said, sometimes I'm asked about Vedanta, so I like to ask myself, why would anyone want to study it? What good does it do? If any, how? These questions arise with special insistence. When I see an audience of 20 to 25 people who have gathered out of a city of more than 1 million to hear about Vedanta, how tempting then to question Vedanta's relevance! ! But I don't. There is the constant certainty that someday, this is the faith, if you will, a believer, the Western world will catch fire with the ideas of Vedanta, transforming the landscape, social, cultural, intellectual, educational, moral, and religious. Why? Because Vedanta provides a new paradigm, which the world needs desperately. And incidentally, welcome to the new chairs, aren't they wonderful? This is the world premiere of the new chairs, so I hope you're comfy. And if you go to sleep, it won't be the first time that I've been able to succeed, bring a little peace to somebody. Shankara was famous for that. He'd snore during all. Finally, we found out he had sleep apnea, you know. That was another day's story. So Jesus gives us quite a little laundry list, doesn't he? How we could be busy without getting in too many people's way. Tending for people that we don't even know. I'm not trying to get too provincial here, but it's Prime Minister of Canada the other day said the gesture certainly is touching. That's in quotes, certainly touching. A man named Doso. Remember how Jesus and Mary were trying to find a place to stay? Christmas Eve, having a hard time. I think the reason was they really didn't want them there. The hotels were full, that's true. Canversaries, I think they call them, camel stops. But I think the basic thing was they really just didn't want them there. Speaking through a translator from his home in Red Deer, Altoona, Canada, Ahmed, A-H-M-E-D, also explains that it's an old Arab tradition to name your child after a, quote, person with good character. And so the Syrian refugee has decided to call his 5th son, the first to be born in Canada, Justin. It is true, says, that Justin is Western and we're Eastern and Arabs, but out of my admiration of Trudeau, I had no problem to name my son Justin because I like this person. For me, he's wonderful and compassionate. I hope all leaders, whether Easterners or Westerners, will be like him. Now, you see, here's my problem all of a sudden. We got a little problem here, folks, and it's an individual problem. I'm not trying to be like the jigsaw puzzle people at the moment, because the whole point is we've got to get people of all persuasions, all points of reference, angles of perception in this country to somehow get the idea they want to do good. So let John and Mary do good that way. And if we happen to approve, oh, fine, Mary, fine, John. If we don't, let them go do good. And these people already did good. And we have to sit in reflection the way Vedantists do, a lot of introspection, and try to figure out what is good. I mean, what is really good? What is something I could do for my neighbor if he's good? Well, if he comes in out the rain and he's soaking wet, yeah, I can put him up for the night, but what else? And this is kind of the way I get out of some of these terrible traffic jams we're in, these paradigms, trying to use a different ruler. I'm not asking you to follow this, but this is the way it comes to me. It's a different way of looking at it. It's a question. So, my friends, we got 11 million people here. We don't know how they got in, and we don't know where they are, and we don't know this, and we don't know that, we don't know the other thing. And it's bad news bears and broke the law. What law? I saw a sign the other day, no individual is illegal. That's another question. My folks sure were illegal when they first stepped on these shores. And what do we got? We got a rousing welcome for a while. But the point is, looked at from sub specii aeternitatis, maybe the way God's, who knows? We gave them a hot meal. We gave them a roof over their heads. We got 11 million people. We don't quite know what happened, but they're out of poverty now. And if we were Christians, I got to read that book more carefully. I got to read those lines again. If we were Christians, say primarily or something like that, we might be feeling real dandy that we got 11 million on their feet, paying taxes, working, having dreams for their children. You see, reason is entirely different than ideology. It is on any side you want to stand on. And I see Vivekananda understanding with reason every time. Sure, we can't open the gates to the whole world. Everybody be poor. Nobody be able to figure out what to do next. But my friends, we are the whole world, and we have a deep, deep problem in this world. The world has become obese. And the real illegal aliens, my friends, are unwanted babies. And although people have done things illegally, I will tell you right now, in the same paradigm, if they're here, what are you going to do with them? To me, there are no illegitimate babies. But here's a little problem. You know, you got to have a license to go fishing. You notice that? And to drive a car. My friends, you have to have a license to be a daddy. It's called a marriage license. So there may be some illegitimate daddies, but they're not illegal. Not in God's eyes. So let's just take a little while looking at what this ideal society might be. We're supposed to straighten up and fly right, you know, put our suspenders on. They got suspenders now that make you stand up straight, you know. Okay, that's better. But the thing is that the Greeks had quite an idea about it, didn't they? Very, very interesting how they thought they might go about this thing. And I think they may have had something rather important to say. Oh, you know what? Oh, boy, this is going to be a problem. Are you willing to go upstairs in the closet and get two Sharpies out of the hip pocket of my pants that I have in there?
Sure.
Yeah, he'll do it. He'll see. The Greeks had an idea which got translated to Roman so we could understand it. And it said, mens sana in corpore sano. Take a little baby boy, a little baby girl. The goal is a sound mind and a sound body. Pretty good stuff for Greeks, you know. Just a stage or two away from barbarism. I'm not going into the fact that India figured it out thousands of years, way under BC. Everything. We saw the picture of Ramanujan last night, didn't we? Beautiful. So the Indians here thousands of years ago, and now the men and women that brought the atomic age to birth, most of whom I'm saying are mystics, you know, and still we're trying to catch up. But the Greeks did pretty good with that concept. And I'm going to add something else to the paradigm. I'm going to add another angle to the triangle called an emotions. And the emotions are something that have been pretty much ignored in our Western theology. Yeah, that's even better. I don't worry, God is good. These are not the ones I came with. I better leave it.
Try and record. They actually need the.
Let me show you what I have in mind here. I think we can get this in the field of view. We're talking about the ideal society now. This here we'll call body. We don't have a lot of time. This we'll call mind. And now I want to add to this paradigm of the human condition, emotion. I think this is a pretty good model for an education of a child. Strong in body, strong in mind, and dealing with the development, the flowering, and the strengthening in power. That means control of one's independence, of the horse, of our wonderful emotions like love. I think we could start a school. I think we must start a school. Sooner or later, I see Vedanta having to start. Not to abandon, as some of them trying to improve education now by abandoning the poorest schools, the worst schools. Lord, where are they going with that? I don't know. But nevertheless, I think that's not a bad way to begin the game. And I think I'll just mention quickly as we pass that Plato had some interesting things to say about that in the Republic. He said, okay, we're going to have an ideal society here. So what we want to try to do is make sure that the leaders are brought up well. From babyhood. And interestingly enough, the two important parts of his educational approach were athletics and music. Now, I don't know about you all, probably every one of you is born in this century and certainly a long time after I was. But when I was going to school, these were the two things that were pushed to the wings of the education. Athletics and music. Nobody went to school, with the possible exception of Edwin McDowell, who went to Columbia, to become a great composer. Oh yeah, it's good to go to school and learn how to play the piano and so forth, but the composing comes from somewhere else. Often, I suppose, sitting under a great teacher, being inspired by a great teacher. But nevertheless, these were the two things. And, says Socrates in Plato's words, I want the women and the men to be educated equally. Not only equally well, but with the same courses. Athletics and music. It's kind of unusual. And what he said was, using Sparta as his model, I suspect, as he did in more than one thing, that if you train boys only in gymnastics, you're likely, not just maybe, but you're bound to end up with a militaristic bunch of guys when they go off to be 18, 19, 20, 21 to send them off to war. So let's get some music in there to talk about a whole personality. And the same thing in reverse, if you wish, with the women. Now, India has such interesting ideas about everything. They've got the idea that we have different temperaments. Hey, have you noticed that? Just try community living for a while. God needs a plumber. God needs a guy to make cakes. God needs a guy. I mean, it's amazing. And you would never meet these people, even on a bus. And you're thrown together for life. I call monastic living, you know, life without possibility of parole. I'm too old to start over. What can I say? So here they have the idea of different temperaments already. But we haven't taken this into consideration in our modern educational system. I hear today, just for example, these are throwing out technical, we're changing tires this morning, Mom, just in case you want, on the freeway. I hear tell that now the biggest schools in the country want you to have a 700 grade on the Stanford Achievement Test in mathematics. Well, I stand here today to tell you, I believe, I never get into school with that kind of requirement. Hey, man, I love literature. I even love listening to people speak, especially if they got something to say. I mean, some other day, you know, like Lincoln or somebody. I wouldn't make it. My dad told my sister, dad was a chemistry teacher, and I stand on science, hard rock science. He said, you love music. What a great thing he said. He said, but I want you to know, and I want you to know, that I see the same beauty in mathematics that you do in music. Now, if we've got a bell-shaped curve here, and if the bell-shaped curves are slightly different, who knows? It's women that are going to have to do this, you know, because it's your millennium. This third millennium is yours. And I think the first thing, have you ever heard Marilyn Ferguson? She preaches these days. She's not talking. She's not just talking. She's a bugle call. She's mama. I've heard her. What they're going to do is they say, okay, boys, now you sit over there and you sit over there. It's downtime like Dennis the Menace, and don't fight. And rolling up the sleeves, says, now we're going to get down to really working on solving, better a doer than a sayer, on these real problems that we have. All of them, because it's all one big organic problem. And I don't want to get too sociological all in one morning, but I happen to think that the equation for survival, a couple of Swamis in India have said, therefore, if two have said it, I know one, I'm saying the Swamis in India are saying that the survival of the human species, like this millennium, depends on the feminization of the planet. So I know of at least five great leaders. Marilyn's one of them. There's a lady named Rose from New Zealand that showed up at the Parliament of Religions. Oh, my goodness. And the point is, Marilyn will say, after pointing out that this is the time for the God country view, the problem is the equation for human survival, as far as I'm concerned, very simple. Natural resources, overpopulation. You make of it what you will. I see all the four horsemen of the apocalypse riding on that one equation. War, famine, starvation, everything you want. Ill health, lack of education of women. So this is our time. What a great time. Allons enfants de la patrie, le jour de gloire est arrivé. Come, children of the country. The day of glory has arrived for real solutions to real problems. And who better? I'm asking you. You think about it in your own life experience than mama. And incidentally, the women did this one time called the Peace of the Iroquois. The men just were, they were psychotic. I mean, the Aztecs were psychotic. From the Spanish, they were worse than the Spanish for good. I mean, what? But the Iroquois, they were just fighting everybody they could. I met an Apache once. I said, you'd cut yourself shaving. He said, yeah, if I can't find somebody else to come. The little boy, this is an Indian joke, asked the preacher. He said, you know, I noticed you cut yourself shaving. He said, well, yes, it did. I did, son. He said, I was preparing my lecture, my sermon for the morning, and I was concentrating on that, and I cut myself shaving. He said, well, he said, Reverend, he said, I think in the future, if you'd concentrate on the shaving and cut the lecture, you might be better off. India's got people that are highly intellectualistic, left hemisphere. They understand there are people that are all heart. We call them artists. If mathematics is the language of science, then surely art is the language of emotion around the world. I happen to love folk singing. I don't care what country it's from. It speaks to me. We have people who are real workers. They'll cut through a problem and see what has to be done immediately and do it. And the glory of the human species is the sublime discernment that came when we got a big frontal cortex up here, big forehead. The ability to sit down and replay the day's activities when we get back to the cave. Mm-hmm. It's called temporal delay. Cortex. The ability to go within. If the sun goes down, we can light a fire. When we got light bulbs, we stay up and read. So with these four propensities blended into one whole, hey, we got a nice little human being coming along here, don't you think? Jnana and Bhakti. And you know, these things are all scrambled up. If you think it's all cut and dried and simple, when I came here, I was quite sure that, because it was necessary, that I wanted to see God, be with God, be one with God. And then I found out, it took me a while. I asked Brahmananda to help me. Mother, there, I took pictures one day on a Sunday afternoon. What am I going to do? Is it, what's for me? Is it this one, that one? Different people have different paths. But the holistic path, the bakery recipe, has helped you and your guru make that one up. And I said, am I going to go with the path of jnana, the path of bhakti? What is it? And all of a sudden, I guess Brahmananda just took the thing in his own hands and gave me a feeling of elevation. And the question kind of came meaningless, you know, like Einstein. He says, it's not answered at the same level you ask the question. But I learned that for me, okay, so supposing like you think it's going to happen 24 hours from now, you're one with Brahman. I'm just trying to be pragmatic, my friends, like an American changing the tire on the freeway. Came to me. Well, that's okay. Within 24 hours. But you know, you got about 21 more days to think about it on Earth. You'll be so happy. You'll be in such sublimity that you just won't want to stay around here anymore. And things like that came to my mind. So I said, well, I came here with the idea if they'll just let me meditate a little while every day, I'll do anything they ask. So why don't I kind of give up worrying about how much of this and how much of that and one or the other? Prabhupada never talked about one or the other. He'd take you and you and you'd talk to him personally. You know what he said? You know what he said to me? He said, how do you think of God? Imagine that. This man had seen God, shaking hands with God, and he's asking me, how do you feel about it? It could be crafted together. But when they come to Swami, when they come to Sri Ramakrishna, and say, you know, which is it going to be? Is it going to be faith first? Or is it going to be love? Is it going to be praying first? Is it going to be love? When Sri Ramakrishna was asked how to find God, Swami says, Prabhupada, he said, love and pray. The disciple asked, which comes first? This was Swami, Sri Ramakrishna talking to a particular individual. You got that? You understand? One kind of person. He said, love, and then pray. Now, when I heard that, it struck me that it should have been first pray, and then love. But then it dawned on me that unless you have love, that interest in God, you would not pray. Pray does not mean, God, I want this, give it to me. Pray means, how can I find him? Pray means that you can have his vision. So I suspect that the Greeks here have gone pretty far with this beautiful concept of a wonderful, and you know, it's more than we have time for, but those statues they built, they're not just statues, you know, they're not statues. The Greeks had quite a few hundred years behind them of the Egyptians and all their gods, whatever, they walk around with animal heads. Greeks just took off the heads. Most of those statues are gods and goddesses. They represent something spiritual, something ideal, Vivekananda calls it spiritual humanism.
Not bad. That might be part of a new paradigm.
You know, it's very difficult to read Genesis and read it as a geological or an astronomical text of the origin of the universe. Brother Leakey, I met him, and he did a good job of it. He said, yeah, well, they got the order right, you know. First the water, then the land, and then the fish, and then the animals. And then Cain and Abel, one was a hunter-gatherer, the other was an agriculturist. He's a pretty good fellow. But we do need a new paradigm. And one of the good questions is, where to seek for God? It could be a song like that. Where to seek for God? Seek him inside your heart. Kurt Vonnegut, before we leave the Greeks for a second here, wrote a wonderful lecture, a letter to high school kids who'd written him. Now this is not the education that they're giving in the schools. I forgot to tell you, art and athletics are the two things they're cutting and have been for years in trying to bring up little ideal children that don't want to fight, that aren't really almost forced to fight. Well, you know, the gang boys force you to fight. Think of that. This country has a whole other half that, just like Bob Dylan, who, whatever, talk about controversial, won the Nobel Prize, we just turn and pretend we just don't see. We don't see. We don't see. We really don't see the people that are in prison that we need to have a chaplain's class to go see. And it's time for us not to dwell in the dark side of the world's story, or bathe in it, or wallow in it, or all of that, becry it. Certainly not just do that. That's the worst thing, almost, to know it's there and just to talk about it. Not to pull it, you know, embrace it to our chest and bemoan and wail the fate of the planet. Time has come to do something about it. One step at a time, and it may be with your own friends, and your own family, and your own children. Not a bad place to... But the emotion thing has been pretty well left out since the mystics, the Greek mystical influence, was somehow chopped off. It was like two great trees going together from the Greeks. We went the science route. The church helped us go the Aristotelian, you know, analytical route. The cold weather helped us do that. So we ended up a mess. And he said to these kids, practice any art, music, singing, dancing, acting, drawing, painting, sculpting, poetry, fiction, essays, reportage, no matter how well or badly, not to get money and fame, but to experience becoming, to find out what's inside you, to make your soul grow. Seriously, says exclamation points. I mean, starting right now, do art and do it for the rest of your lives. Draw a funny or a nice picture of Ms. Lockwood and give it to her. Dance home after school, singing. So they asked Ramakrishna about some of these things, and if you think everything is as it seems, you know, they try to tell us in Vedanta that things are not what they seem, world of appearance. Well, I suggest you not just take Vedanta at the face value of what it seems the first day. No less a luminary, a galaxy in his own right, than our Vivekananda, your friend and mine. I lived in his home for 13 years, you know, Pasadena, South Pasadena. He said, I'm a Ghani on the outside. I'm a Bhakta on the inside. Bhakta, man of love. He said, now you take Ramakrishna, Sri Ramakrishna. Oh, and incidentally, if I've ever done anything good in my life, it's he who done it, not me. Chalk up the mistakes to the things I may have done. He said, but Sri Ramakrishna was a Bhakta on the outside and a Jnani on the inside. To people that don't have this dualism, you're either one or the other, and one is definitely inferior and one is superior, whichever stand. Hey, we don't have that from the Brahmananda tradition that Swami Atmatattwananda founded. We don't have that. Why? Because Brahmananda makes it so clear. Love is love. And it's the easiest and the most immediate spiritual experience you can have. Swami used to say, we have no excuse. We used to love as babies. And what is knowledge? Light. Brahmananda says that. Well, now, who of us would want to have one without the other? Especially since the end game is all the same. So I'm saying that what we need, basically, for the ideal society is whole human beings. And here's where it gets to be fun for me. This is what I suspect is the future that we're all looking for, individually and collectively. Body, right? Mind and emotions. And that superlatively glorious experience of the human species of introspection, sitting inside this pyramid, meditation. Now, if we, instead of putting it off into the future, start thinking about our children and our own lives, start there. If we can build that ideal society, there's no reason we can't want to emulate the Greeks in terms of their whole view of a sound mind in as strong a body as we can maintain as we go through this life on our way to God. But how about adding the dimension of emotion? How about talking about bringing our children up to be whole human beings with all four yogas blended? And may I point out to us that Raja Yoga is called the royal path. Raja, Rani, you know, we don't live up there in Los Angeles. Maybe you thought we did, but we don't. The city that we live in is not Los Angeles. It's the city of Mary. Mary. La Reina de los Angeles. The Queen of the Angels. And what are human beings? A little higher than the animals, a little lower than the angels. And we just must not stop. We can't stop. So then you see the problem is that in the societal realm, as we start meditating in the home, and Vedanta societies do not meditate enough around the world, they just don't. They have it, but they don't quite realize, a lot of them, that they've got it. They sing a lot, wave some lights. No less a recent Swami that I find a little hard to digest, but he's a great guy. Paramesananda, they're all trying to read his book two or three times, class around there. He says, hey, sometimes I wonder, old Swami and old previous generation, I think maybe that our speaking ministry and in our service ministry, our mission ministry, and our famine relief, hospitals, that may not be enough. We got to meditate. So it's like, as I say, you know, sometimes it's like a marathon. It's like jogging. You run along the roads, as the Greeks would be proud of us, along the highways and byways, and everybody's running, jogging. 25,000 people, 22,300, you tell me what it was in Boston, start out. Pheidippides, if you remember, ran the 26.3 miles or whatever it is from the fields of Marathon, the great victory for freedom and liberty, whatever. And he says, we won! We won! And he keeled over. And here 25,000 people started up. So we got that down. Some people can read, but do we read? After college, do we read? And how about meditation? So I'm thinking that Vedanta in the future is going to be a meditating country. And here's the main point of the whole bit. We really can't wait. We really can't wait for that day to come. Because, my friends, on the first day of January, when we're thinking about our ideal year in front of us, if we don't do it, how will it get done? How will the plant grow? How will there be a Vedanta worldview in America, in your home, in your country, in your city? How will we have started doing something about feeding the babies, taking care of them after they're born? and making sure that every one of them comes into a home, as India says it must be, where they are loved, where they're invited before they're born, because they have such a promising future. Now, I think the most promising future that a person can have is to be born in a home of love. And we've noticed that although money helps, a whole lot of it doesn't help too much, and none of it doesn't seem to help a whole lot very often at all. I would like to just offer you this, because I think it's wonderful. Brahmananda says that after the Upanishads, are you with me? The founder of this place, yeah? And the Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam is the most authoritative of the Indian scriptures. It's holistic Vedanta is what it is. And I would like to say this because it's just a lovely story. Talking about a fellow named Dhruva. And he finally got his heart's wish that the great Saint Narada, and incidentally, the Bhakti Sutras by Narada, great, great book to give even your Christian. I say we got to go out and shine on the Gentiles, you know? Not words, not even deeds only, but being. It's who you are, how your friends feel about you at the workplace after 40 years. So now he's going along and following his Vishnu, his chosen ideal, and Vishnu sent Narada down. Okay, I hear you're calling. Now, how about this? So he's been at it for a while. It says, with the 6 months, he went still deeper into meditation. Veil after veil of ignorance and darkness was lifted. He beheld the divine light, the divine being, his chosen ideal, Vasudeva, Vishnu, dash, smiling, benign, dash, within the shrine of his heart. The experience was so real, the divine presence so vivid, that the world of sense vanished into nothingness. Dhruva's blessedness was inexpressible. To him, the radiant immanence of God was all. And then Vishnu spoke to him, said, I know thy heart, my child, thou didst desire to be a king. Know that thou shalt rule thy father's kingdom for many years. After thy allotted time of life on earth, thou shalt go to that place in heaven called the celestial sphere, where gods and angels and stars circle round and round, singing my praises and glory. Thou shalt be the center of that sphere, and thou shalt be known as the Dhruva Nakshatra, the pole star. Vivekananda said, in America, every man is a king, but a woman's a queen. Our goal is union with God, the One. Our goal is acknowledgement and understanding that we always have been one. And that's why Jesus said, if you do it unto the least of these, my brethren, to a baby, was a future before her and him. Do it unto me. And conversely, Marian Williamson, I just think she's something, says if you hurt a baby, even by neglect, especially by physical, intellectual, emotional, spiritual neglect, she's speaking of God now with a capital G. You're doing it to him. I think that seen as an opportunity instead of a challenge that's beyond us, an opportunity no more difficult than setting aside at least 15 minutes a day, let's say, in one place, in one's own home, in one's own heart, in reflection, and when the right time comes with some encouragement and some good guidance from our baseball manager, our head swami, whoever that may be at the moment, who has trod this path with the concentration of a scientist, and the total love of an artist, and yes, the dedication of a monk, that we might be very surprised how much the world has changed, even in our own vision, on January 1st, 2018. God love you. This could well be my last trip with you, because, you know, as Vivekananda says, he's been thrown out of halls bigger than this. So I'm talking about my brothers and sisters, literally, my family, a severely strong slice, a big fat slice of the pumpkin pie right here, giving us strength and us commitment and us encouragement. Let's just see how we do. I wanted to put this up here so you could see it, because I think it's just so beautiful. To me, this is it. The ideal society, right? And the future of Vedanta. I call him the four yoga man. And incidentally, let's just establish the American principle of free speech. We don't want to be unnecessarily controversial, certainly not divisive, but anybody's thought is respected, honored, and revered here. Anybody want to add something? Bring some carrots and potatoes and onions to the stew.
Anybody like to ask any questions or comments? Just raise your hand so we can...
If you want a notepad and pencil, Swami Sarvadevananda can supply them whenever you want.
Siobhan, usually you have questions.
Oh, God, the only random thing that came to my head, which is a little...
Hold on, just wait for a moment.
Not relevant was, because he mentioned Lincoln so many times.
Yeah.
I also admire Lincoln.
Good for you.
What messages, what excerpts from his writings would be most important right now as we enter into a new administration and just a new year in general, in a new era of what you called a rising tide of feminism?
It's an amazing thing, because Lincoln's book, you understand, is his life. And he evolved just the way any of us try to do, would, will. And he was a man that apparently passed everything by his own experience. Swami Shraddhananda loves him. He was told when he left in India, he said, "You're going to America." He said, "Study Lincoln and you'll know, understand the heart and mind of the American people." He learned from experience. The sermons that Shraddhananda has on tape about Lincoln are fabulous. He said, it seems to me that he knew something about his own inner being. We'd call it the Atman, some depths there. Because he kept doing things that were off the wall. Off the wall, talk about mercy. He kept pardoning boys that had run away from the battlefield. He lived to see the virtual collapse of the South and Appomattox, but he himself was Southern. That's why his face, after not 8 years, but not even six, not even 5 years in office, looks like a furrowed field. Because every time a man fell, black or white, north or south, he fell. So I don't feel so bad about Lincoln having been killed anymore. He's just the last soldier to go. And at a White House celebration that victory had virtually been achieved, Lee had surrendered, he said, "Oh, I see you have a band with you." "I'd like to hear them play Dixie." Now, engagement, I think, is what we're talking about here. I'm not just asking you to go out and do social work, though I do think we have to really face the problem that we have a lot of people suffering in this country. And I don't care who it is, if a good suggestion comes up about how we can do something to help each other, because they are our brothers and sisters, let's get at it. Let's get on it. But this is not a very pleasant thing, but it's an important thing to realize that no matter how dark it gets, you can always see the stars, and we have our pole star. We have our guiding light, and it's God, and it's to find God. It's to become one with that light. So Lincoln was talking one day here. He said, and this was an issue, something in the air. You're going to have to let the black man vote. Now I say that you think about it, you go home and think about it, but you're going to have to let him vote because a lot of you folks got out of serving in the Army. It was as simple as paying $100, called a greenback thing. You get a substitute go for you. But whatever. And you didn't go. And a lot of what we call African Americans today, they did go, and they died. Now, the America that we don't understand, because we really need to find out about what's going on in your town and mine and a few blocks from home, and at least have a plan and a program and do something, I suspect. A lot of us don't know that a quarter of the men in uniform at the end of the war, in blue, were African American. So Lincoln, like Jesus, says, you know what we've got to do? We haven't been doing it for a while. We've got to love. The manifestation, the shining form of God in the other person. As much as we love the thought that we can find that shining form in ourselves. And there was a young man in the crowd, just assembled out of doors. He said, that's the last speech that man's going to give. His name was John Wilkes Booth. So my friends, glory, hallelujah. Le jour de gloire est arrivé, the day of glory has arrived. God in our own heart. God in Swami used to say, look for God here first, and then in your guru, and then in everyone. 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 God love you. See you up the road. I want people to be my fife and drum corps. That's a pretty good deal, isn't it? That guy looks pretty happy. Okay, John Ma, I'm going to leave these here for a moment.